a semi-regular-ish upload schedule, so that's pretty nice. So last time, in part 3.2, we talked a little bit about animation. Here we're going to talk about some more intricate ways of manipulating models through code. In a nutshell, I'm going to talk about attachments, controllers, hitboxes, and animation events. So let's start off with attachments. They're conceptually pretty simple. If we look at Barney in the model viewer, we'll see he's got a single attachment point. Can you guess what it's for? It's for the muzzle flash when he shoots his gun in-game. Feel free to explore Half-Life's model files, you'll find quite a few of these. If your entity inherits from C-base animating, you can use the getAttachment method. It looks like this. It's got three parameters. Attachment is the ID of the attachment starting from 0, and origin and angles are the output position and output angles respectively. In order to use it, you gotta declare two vectors before it and pass them as arguments. Just like that. Let's do a more advanced example though. Let's write an entity that plays an animation and spews out fire particles. First, we're going to write a particle object class. We're going to use the fire sprite or an explosion sprite because it looks nice, set some random frames, set the render mode to additive, set up the move type and all that other stuff so it can bounce around, like a particle would. In its think method, it's going to decrease its opacity until it becomes invisible. I hope you understand by now that think is something that gets called, well, in this case, roughly every frame, and as we are decreasing the opacity by 1 or 2, it's gradually, over time, gonna become completely transparent. In this case, once it does, the sprite is gonna get deleted so it can free up entity slots. Anyway, now we can move on to our actual example. Inherit from C-base animating, load Barney's model, play the reload animation because that's where his arm moves quite a bit, but also make sure to precache our particle object entity. If you don't precache it right here, the game's gonna exit later on because the sprite isn't precached. Remember that precache is only called when entities are spawning for the first time, that is when the map is loading. So it doesn't really take into account any entities that are spawned dynamically, so we gotta do those by ourselves. Finally, in think, we're gonna rotate the entity, obtain the transformation data for Barney's gun attachment, convert the angles of that into a direction vector so we can use it as a movement direction for velocity, and finally, spawn the particle entity. You might be wondering though, how? How do we do that? Well, here we learn about getClassPointer, so yay, this lesson is a 2-in-1, I guess. GetClassPointer is a really weird function, because in order to create a new entity with it, you need to pass null pointer as the argument. Otherwise, it's just gonna give you a pointer to whatever entity you pass to it. Anyway, this is basically how you would use it to spawn new entities. And that's it. You get a really cool particle show, just don't spawn too many, else you're gonna break the engine. Now, onto controllers. Controllers are just things that manipulate either the position or rotation of a bone in some axis. You can use the setBoneController method to set the value of a controller. You can check what controllers your model has got by viewing it in the model viewer and going to the bones tab. You can also go to body parts, I think, and actually control the controllers, so you can see what they do. By the way, you can't change the mouth controller in-game, it is controlled by the audio system in the engine it seems, so feel free to ignore that one. Let's write a simple entity that rotates the player's back via controllers. As usual, we're gonna set some model, initialize default animation stuff, set a sequence, and start thinking. I added a couple of variables so we can nicely alternate between left and right. Torso is going to be the angle of the torso, and according to the model viewer, it goes between positive 30 and negative 30 degrees. That's easy enough. And that's basically all there is to know about controllers, really. Half-Life NPCs typically use them for neck rotation, but you can use them for anything, really, like robot arms, the steering wheel in a car, or the RPM gauge in a car. I think you get the idea by now. Now, hitboxes. These are really cool, and I think you know what they are. Basically, they're boxes that are attached to a bone, and they're used to detect if an NPC has been shot, and more specifically, in which part of the body it's been shot. There's basically a concept of hitbox groups in Gold Source. For instance, there's a group for the head, a group for the torso, legs, hands, and so on. It's basically supposed to have, I don't know, separate damage values or whatever. I mean, that's generally what they're used for. Hitbox groups are determined by the modeler in the QC file, and you'll see what I mean once you decompile a model. In order to do that, grab this tool called Crowbar, select Half-Life or anything in Gold Source, navigate to the model file, and decompile it. If we do that for the human grunt, you'll see that Hitbox 6 is basically the left leg, Hitbox 1 is the head, but there's also Hitbox 11, which I presume is the helmet. We'll check this later. Looking at it in the model viewer, it kinda looks like it, not gonna lie. So yeah, let's use this for our example entity. We're gonna write an entity that reports which hitbox group was hit. In Half-Life, you cannot get information on which individual hitboxes were hit. You need to use the hit groups. Here's the problem though. We can't get this info in Take Damage, so where on earth can we get it? Allow me to introduce you to TraceAttack. TraceAttack is called not by the engine, but rather the combat code in the SDK. Feel free to explore combat.cpp and see for yourself. Ultimately, TraceAttack calls Take Damage, so yeah, the entire damage in combat stuff is not the engine's concern, it's all done in the SDK, fortunately. Also, check out the Human Grunt's TraceAttack implementation. It definitely confirms that 11 is indeed the helmet hitbox. Alrighty, so let's write this entity. Use the Grunt model, set up some stuff as usual, and now write TraceAttack. And oh look, isn't that our old friend TraceResult? You really thought trace lines were over and we'd never see them again, didn't you? Well, I got bad news for you. Revise your vector maths. But yeah, you can obtain the hitbox group from this trace result structure. Let's whip up something real quick just to demonstrate. We're basically just gonna print the hit group to the console. It's very basic, very boring, but you get the idea. It's really just a simple switch case thingy. By the way, you can use r_drawEntities4 to see the hitboxes of each entity. And yeah, that roughly covers hitboxes, there's really not that much to them. Finally, animation events. Now, animation events are something, a point in time that is triggered on a specific frame in a specific animation, right? You can have events for gunshots, melee attacks, setting other animations, displaying effects, even triggering entities by name, and it's all in the animator's control. Events are typically defined by their ID and a parameter string. For now, we're just going to focus on these IDs, and since this series isn't about modeling, we're not going to create a new animation event just yet. However, if you're a modeler or animator and you want to make your NPC do something unique in the middle of an animation, you could very well use this. Now, here's the thing, we're going to take one of the existing models and try to reinterpret their events. The method that interprets animation events is a conveniently named handleAnimEvent. And if we look at Barney's implementation of it, you can see he's got three custom defined animation events. We're gonna implement just one, that is the shooting one, and we're gonna adapt our very first example to it. Instead of spewing fireballs in Think, we're only gonna spawn them when they're meant to, during the animation. There's just two little things we gotta take care of, and that is manually looping the animation, calling dispatchAnimEvents. The handling itself is more or less a simple switch case. That's really it. When interpreting the shooting event, we call the shoot method, which is just copy-pasted from our first example, and there, that's it. Now, this particle show is looking less impressive right now, but it's a lot more flexible on the flip side, and it can be made to look a lot better with some tweaks, like spawning multiple fire sprites instead of one, but I'll leave that up to you, as well as giving you some extra homework and ideas. Admittedly, this was a pretty hasty lesson. Lots of stuff got packed into a single video, but hopefully it's all gonna settle in by next month. Cause next month, we're gonna talk about special effects using temporary entities. These are things like explosions, gunshot effects, smoke, sparks, decals, dynamic lights, and so on. And after that, we're gonna do sprites, laser beams, and other parametric effect entities. And this chapter is pretty much done, really. And until then, happy programming.